Hi, I'm Gerardo from AWS.
And I'm Luke from Monzo, and this is my architecture.
So today we're going to talk about Monzo's core banking platform. What can you tell me about this platform?
So to just give you an introduction to Monzo, so we're a bank that's a fully regulated bank operating in the UK currently. We've got around 8 million customers, and that's a mix of like current account customers and business customers. And we were founded in 2015 with a mission to make money work for everyone. So one of the key like architectural principles we've taken to building our platform, mate, is that we've got global ambitions as a bank. So we've got to build a global platform to take us there.
Great. So let's dive in. So if this is a banking platform, presumably you have payments flowing through this?
Yes.
How about you take me through the journey of a payment?
Yeah, good. So for easy example, maybe you're a Monzo customer and you're picking up your morning coffee from a coffee shop on the way into work in the morning. You've just got to the till and ordered from the barista, and you've just been charged $3 and you tap your card on the payment terminal in the shop. So that payment gets routed through one of our payment schemes, through our physical data centers, into our AWS Direct Connect, and then that ends up in our core banking platform.
Okay, so this is how you're getting transaction information and presumably credit card information?
Yep.
Okay, what happens next?
Yeah, so at this point, we don't want to be passing any like sensitive card like details for our platform, so that hits our tokenization service, and this just removes all like sensitive information, so you're just dealing with a token rather than an actual card number.
Okay. Presumably these are microservices, because I see that you're pairing some of these services with databases.
Yes, yeah, that's right. So we've got about 2,600 microservices on our platform at the moment, which are all within Kubernetes, so EKS. Mm-hmm. And the basic flow here is that every microservice that needs to store state will have a database associated with it, which we're storing Keyspaces. Okay. So to sort you through like the basic flow once you've made sure that there's no sensitive information being passed around the platform, is that we will make sure that card is like a valid card, that it's not blocked, it's not frozen for any reason. And we do that by making a call over to our backend data store in Keyspaces to make sure that that card exists.
Okay.
Once we know that that's fine, we make sure that card is associated with an account, which again, we do another check, which is basically a read against that data store. And then the final thing is to make sure that as a customer, you actually have enough money to make the purchase for your coffee in the morning. And then we do some basic calculations on your ledger there.
Okay. And if everything's good, I'm guessing that you confirm the payment?
That's it.
Okay.
So this flow is all synchronous. So we've got like a small number of seconds to be able to return a response to the payment terminal. So that just goes straight back out with a like yes or no decision about whether we can process the transaction or not.
So presumably this whole architecture is architecture around speed. How does Cassandra play a part in that speed?
Yeah, so the synchronous flow, low latencies is super important for us, and like the overall performance of the platform is super important. When we decided to use Cassandra as our like data store when we were building the bank, there were two key things that we were looking for. One of them was that we could horizontally scale the service in future as we like build the business and take on more customers. And that could also go multi-region. And then secondly is that it needed to be fast.
Yes, okay. And you've been operating on a Cassandra platform for a while, even before Keyspaces was available.
Yes.
So tell me about it. What were some of the challenges you had, and tell me about your decision to move to Keyspaces?
Yeah, so when we looked at like the total cost of ownership of running our own Cassandra environments, we used to manage Cassandra directly on top of EC2. Yeah. And we found that as the business was scaling, we were just spending more and more time doing like routine operations, like scaling our clusters out. And the blast radius of incidents when they happened was actually quite large, where you could have like, you ran into problems around noisy neighbors. And when we looked at the Keyspaces product, that gave us really, really good like performance guarantees around like super low single seconds and single millisecond latencies.
Okay.
And it ticked the boxes with like scaling in the future.
Okay, what sort of scale are you running in Keyspaces?
At peak at the moment, we are running about 2 million reads per second against Keyspaces and about 100,000 writes per second.
So how about any limitations around Cassandra? Because obviously with this sort of NoSQL databases that scale really well horizontally, you can bump into challenges with consistency. Are you having any issues around that?
Um, We've solved the problems largely. Like, we're running our ledger on Keyspaces, and like some of the guarantees that you need to provide over a ledger, like, super important if you're a bank. Mm-hmm. So we've had to solve like the problem around double entry bookkeeping ourselves by building like our own transaction services and like a number of other microservices, just so we get the guarantees that we need.
Right, that's good to hear. Okay, so this being a core banking platform, and you mentioning that you're highly regulated in the UK, so how does security play a part in the architecture?
Yeah, so security, you can't run a bank successfully without having like strong security guarantees. So we use a couple of different AWS services to help like secure our platform. We've got things like the WAF externally, but then within the platform as well, we make use of things like AWS CloudTrail. Mm-hmm. And then we've also got some fairly novel use cases with AWS Nitro enclaves.
Great. Presumably to create some isolated environments.
It's like isolating workloads.
Yeah, that's good to hear. So Luke, thank you so much for sharing this architecture with us.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you for watching. This is My Architecture. See you next time.